Call a special meeting of the North Branford Town Council to order for Wednesday, April 6, 2016, at 7:07 p.m. Start first with salute to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call. Here.
Deputy Mayor Quanah.
Here.
Councilor Angeloni.
Here.
Councilor Arvin.
Here.
Councilor Mandelora.
Here.
Councilor Lanning.
Here.
Councilor Miller.
Here.
Councilor Rose.
Al.
First item is fiscal year 2016-2017 budget deliberations. First on the item is education.
Anthony, could you just explain the handout on the special ed excess cost grant and how it related to the question that was posed last night?
Right, there was a question last night inquiring why they were showing a zero for the 13-14 revenue for the special ed excess grant when the state had reported that there was disbursements to the town. And what you have in front of you is the top page is the state Department of Education website report showing the four checks that were cut. And then subsequently is the detailed general ledger listing for the Board of Ed's expense account. And you notice there's four asterisks. Basically what happened was it wasn't counted as revenue to the town. It was given to the Board of Ed as additional money to spend. So we can count it as revenue. That's why if you go back next after that, you see the revenue ledger for that year. There's no reference to special ed excess grant. Because we didn't, that's why it's zero in that form. We didn't count it as revenue for us. It was instructed to give it to the Board of Ed. That happened 2 years. It happened the 12-13 year and the 13-14 year as well. That's why it was a zero. It wasn't our revenue.
Is that consistent with your understanding, Rose and Don?
Joe, what about last year and this year? I mean, this year showed a zero, too, and you've already received $165.
You can't ask me questions. I couldn't possibly answer them.
Okay.
I'm asking you.
Okay. I understand what he's saying about the 13-14 year. I'd like to hear, I think you might want to hear what he has to say about the 14-15 and the 15-16 year.
Yeah. Absent a motion or an action from you guys, the default is that it becomes town revenue. So you, what happened in those earlier years, there was motions made to forward the money back to the Board of Ed as additional money to spend. Absent that kind of a motion, it defaults to town revenue.
But it didn't show.
So with that, Anthony, and I don't know anything about this, but so if it's true that the state's showing they sent us $165,000 this year,
yep.
Where is that money, and can we use that money to reduce the mill rate?
It's general fund revenue, and the reason why it didn't show is because it came in 2/22/16. That column is January 31st, 2016.
Okay.
So that's why it didn't show.
All right. So is that income earmarked already for this budget?
We do not budget it at all.
Okay.
Because we don't know the dollar amount. It's found money to the town.
So what we do is it goes into general fund.
General
fund.
So does it become part of surplus?
Right. It becomes like any other revenue source at the end of the year. The revenues are closed out. The expenses are closed out. Whenever the plus or minuses are, reverts back to the fund balance.
So it's undesignated. It goes into the undesignated
unassigned,
fund
correct.
The unassigned fund balance.
Correct.
So we'd be using some of that in the $350,000 that we're
correct.
Taking out of the bank
right.
to do this.
Does correct. That mean we can add to that $350 to offset the mill rate without there being any kind of
yeah, manager? I mean, how where are we at? Good question, Dan.
I mean, you could look at the $350 as a base. That's been our base traditionally year after year. The problem with wavering off the $350 is, say you did the $500 this year, pick a number. You have a $500,000 hole. Next year you have to
right.
If you want to go back into the fund balance for additional money, I would be more comfortable taking it like we did in the past for capital expenditures. which is more of a one-time. Our 350 base, we've been consistent, 350 base towards the budget for several years. If you want to, if you think there's a little bit of cushion in the fund balance, and there probably is a little bit, I would suggest you take it out of, towards capital expenditures.
So one more thing, if you could clear up on that fund balance, because I know a lot of us counselors that were up here thought that we weren't able to use it last year.
Right.
Somebody was quoted in a newspaper article that we bit the bullet and couldn't use it last year, but yet it shows in our budget book that we did use it last year. So did we use it last year?
You budgeted $350,000. If you call last year at the end of 2014, we were right at 10%. So we squeaked out the 350 to apply to the 15-16 budget. We were at the end of 14, we did the 15-16 budget, we put 350 towards it. Going back a couple years prior to that, we took money out for the OPEB, we took money out for capital, but at that point in time, we were at the 10%, we were at the bottom. If we went any lower, it would have violated our policy, and Moody's and those folks really looked down on that. So last year, this current year, 15-16, we put 350 towards the budget, which was the most we could put at that point. Subsequently, we closed the books for 15, we had another positive year, and I believe at the end, we were like 11.8% at the end of 2015. So is there a cushion? Certainly. This year looks like another favorable year. The winter's been kind to us. So, I mean, could it be another positive year? Definitely. So if you want to take a little bit more out of fund balance, again, I would just be hesitant to take it towards the budget because that creates a recurring hole year after year.
Right.
I'd rather take it towards capital.
You're kicking it down the road if you...
Exactly. You're just creating a bigger hole in next year's budget to fill.
Okay. Joe, can I thought you were asking the question. Can I respond or just...
It's fine with me. The mayor's the one that makes the decision.
Go ahead, Scott.
Thanks, Michael. Just looking at 12-13, it indicates that $349,961 was paid in February and May, and that $349,000 went back to the board. In 13-14, it's the same pay structure in February and May. $240,000, $495 went back to the Board of Ed. This past year, $196,392 did not go back to the board. So, and this year there's $165 in the first payment. May will be the second payment. We don't know what that amount's going to be. So my question is, 4 years ago, and I thought it was established here, Al, help me out.
No, we did it 4 years ago.
That was going to happen 4 years ago. Then in 13-14 that happened again, but then last year it didn't, and is it because there was no motion? I guess I'm confused with...
That's correct.
Well, that's what Anthony's...
Well, the motion, let's go back, look at 14-15. The motion in 14-15 was we increased the Board of Ed budget by $620,000, of which $350,000 was an increase to their budget, and we were going to use up to $270,000 of special ed excess grant to fund the $600,000. So their budget increased $620,000. We never got the $270,000 of special ed money in. So that's how the 14-15 went down. It was the motion was made to increase their budget by $620,000, of which $350,000 was increasing the budget per se, and $270,000 was gonna be the fill-in from special education. We were gonna get that as a means to cover their increased budget. That's that was the wording for 14-15.
So how much did we get out of the $270,000?
$192,000. So we increased the budget and never got the money to cover it, basically.
Well,
if you want to get that.
May I just say something?
Go ahead, sir.
It sounds like you changed the procedure back to keeping the money, but I want to remind the council that the state statute is clear that if we run over the amount that you've given us for that in the budget, the town has to give us that excess cost because the statute says the excess cost goes to the school. So I think, I personally think you need some sort of firm procedure so every year we know what's going on. So we know if we're getting the $165,000 that came in, you know, like we did a couple years ago, or if we're not getting it, just so that we can plan. And I also think it behooves everyone to log all of that, you know, going in, going out, so that people know where the money is.
So using that formula, is the assumption that the 165,373 that has already come in February, there's going to be another chunk in May, is that money coming back to the board or no?
There wasn't any motion at last year's budget to give, because this is...
15-16 month.
Right.
Right.
So when we did the 15-16 budget last year, what you're saying is there was no motion to say the excess cost grant money would go to the Board of Ed.
So that money is going to go into...
The general fund.
Right, unless you guys change, you could certainly make a motion to change the path. I mean, that's...
Well, we allocated and budgeted for $620,000 of increased expenditures.
14-15,
that's
correct.
Yeah, 14.
Within the mill rate, we only
recouped
provided for $350,000.
Right, we anticipated getting the balance, 270 of state money, which did not come.
Which we haven't got. We've gotten 165.
Different year.
Different year.
Okay.
Yeah. This year, current year, Joe, 165,373 has come in.
Yeah.
First payment in February. In May, there's going to be a second payment.
Right.
We don't know what that will be, but, you know, that was my...
Well, the second payment will be much smaller.
Right.
Right. Similar to, if you look down at the other 3 years, it drops off.
And the other thing that I'm sure you're aware of is that the state is considering reducing excess costs as a percentage, and because of the situation up there, it may be reduced.
Yeah, that's why it keeps on dropping each year.
Right, and the if I remember correctly, the 270 that was given in 14-15 was based on estimates from the state on what the excess cost grant is, but that's all dependent on actually what happens on the Board of Ed side, outplacements and everything
right.
else. So the 270 was just an estimate, and that's what we went with, and we ended up getting 190 something. Is that what you said?
Yeah, we had a very expensive placement that ended up not occurring.
Right.
Actually traveled to another town.
So it's hard to estimate basically what they're going to get on excess cost grant money, as we saw.
Correct.
Should quote CCM.
Any further action on the education budget?
The only question I'm left with is if it's mandatory that this money be turned over to the Board of Education, why would we not do that if in fact that is true?
We should make a motion.
Well, it's mandatory if their costs exceed.
Well, I can go get, I have Tom Mooney's law book in my car. I can go get it and show you if you take a break or something.
You know what? Probably the easiest thing is let's not start a legal debate.
Right.
If in fact that is the law, we have to do it. And I don't think that really governs what we're doing tonight because
no.
that's in this year's budget. And we're looking at July 1, 2016. So we've got enough to chew on tonight. Let's leave it alone.
Right. Do you have...
But to be resolved hereafter.
No, right.
Do you have an estimate of excess cost grant for next year based on your budget?
I can, but I did not
okay.
do that.
That would be helpful to get...
So if you want that for tomorrow night, I can certainly do that.
Okay, that would be helpful, yes.
So just I'll be quick. So if we look at this, aren't we funding what you need without that money? I mean,
it comes out of our budget.
Like simplifying this, right? In your budget, we're funding. You're not counting on it at all, but you're budgeting for it. So so the taxpayers are funding it. So the reality is either, and I'm going to simplify it. When that money comes in, either the Board of Ed gets a windfall or the town gets a windfall.
So it's
they recover the cost they've expended.
They recover what we already, the taxpayer already funded it though.
Right.
In full.
Correct.
So I'm having trouble figuring out what's the excess?
Isn't it if they go over, in special ed, if they go over the amount that they have for some reason, they haven't been...
Well, it's like on outplacements,
right.
It's 4.5 times.
We have to pay 4.5 times the cost, and
right.
then the excess clicks in. We have to do all the bookkeeping in order to get the excess that comes in. So I think if you look at the statute, either
the way you worded your motion 2 years ago, which made it really clear, though you overestimated the excess cost that the board was getting it, or doing it the way you did the year before, is a good thing. I mean, that year you cut our budget, or the board's budget.
Yeah, my question would be, if you're already budgeting what you think you need, and we gave it to you, if we were gonna make a motion to give that to you, wouldn't we cut that amount out of your regular budget too?
That's what you did before.
Yeah, Don, have anyone had a problem with Don?
What happened in 13-14, when you allocated those funds to the board, what I then did was went in and reduced, by whatever estimate I had given you, I proposed a reduction to the board budget in round two. In other words, when we went back after the council acted on the budget, and we had to say, okay, we have to reduce by, I don't remember what the number was, $500,000. Well, $200,000 of that, I said, okay, well, we can reduce this because it's going to come from excess costs.
So then we need to get an answer on what the state statute says and see what that is.
Only the state could create a dilemma like this. Money is fungible. If we're allocating funds for them to operate, and then some money shows up, I mean, it should all just wash out. But if there is some statutory mandate that says we must turn this over to the Board of Ed, you're right. We need to know a reasonable estimate of what that amount is, and then we need to reduce their budget accordingly. Or the taxpayers getting hit for that amount of money.
It right. might also be cleaner from an accounting and auditing standpoint if they're accounting for that be shown on their books, I would think, but maybe I'm wrong.
Well, Don, was there some years that you budgeted 100% for special ed, and then when we started doing this, then one year you went to where you didn't budget 100%, you took out the excess costs, and then we went back?
Did, one year the council asked for both.
Okay.
And so what I did that year, and frankly, it was pretty confusing. In my status quo budget, I budgeted full 100% special ed costs. But then in the superintendent's budget, I took out what my estimate of the excess cost grant. So you were sort of dealing with two numbers for special ed. This year, just to make it clear, the budget is for 100% of the special.
We went back
costs.
To the way you were doing it previously. You know, right.
There was no reduction in the budget for special ed excess cost grant.
And was that the way it was done prior to the 13-14 year that you budgeted 100%?
Yeah, I don't remember what happened in 12-13, but prior to that, absolutely.
Okay. But in those years, Anthony, the special ed excess cost grant, when it came in, would just go into general fund if there was?
Well, 12-13 went to the board, but I didn't go past 12-13, to tell you the truth.
Okay.
Sarah?
I just want to say the only reason I brought it up last night was because it was evident that our mill rate was down, we're looking for revenue, and I'm looking at something that's telling me you have 200,000 or thereabouts more revenue than you're aware of. And that's why I mentioned it.
Thank you. That was a good catch.
And I'm asking how we're going to proceed, obviously, with, so we don't go down this road again, that it's either carried and it does, or if it's not, that we have, you know, clarification, you vote on it and make rule from there.
Is that a reasonable assumption of about $200,000 for the next fiscal year in special education costs that we get from the state?
$350, $240, $196, $165 has gone down.
Well, we haven't gotten the second payment.
But if you look at the 165, it's probably going to end up. I mean, I think $200,000 is probably a reasonable ballpark number. Given though, and the one thing that happens with these excess cost grants is all the money or all the eligible grantees submit to the state through it's called CDAC, which is, you know, one of the state programs.
And then at some point, the State Department decides how much money they have and in order to fund all of those requests. And so it gets reduced by some percent. Last year, it got reduced from 100% to like 80%. So whatever we were eligible for, we actually only got 80% of that. Now, if they decide, well, you know, this year the number's going to be lower, and so that ends up taking that number from 80 to 50, then it certainly could be less than 200,000. But, you know, you're not going to know that by the time you have to act.
If Sarah's right, why do you know that? We've got to give it to them. Well, if we use $200,000 as an assumption, we're actually going to our deliberations.
Right, that's why we need the estimated.
How do you want to do it?
Well, Don said that he was going to work up the excess, the estimated excess cost grant, which would be for next year. Correct. So he's going to work those numbers up to give us an estimate.
But I heard Scott say they wouldn't have that till tomorrow.
Correct.
And we know, but we know ballpark based on the history that it's around $200,000.
But keep in mind, the state may reduce the percentage and reimburse.
I would rather see the estimated numbers on that before we do anything. That's me personally. You guys can do what you want. But
when I do the estimate, I can only estimate the students that we
correct.
Have,
mm-hmm.
I'm not going to know what factor that the
right, you might get some during the year, next
and
year.
That, and that can also happen.
Right, and you don't know what the factor is, but at least it's a basis that we can start with.
Does that mean we're not going to do Board of Ed until tomorrow night?
That would be my preference, but if someone, I mean,
so
that's all, that's
on
me.
Meeting, I think.
No, they don't.
No.
Board of Ed's next week.
Phil, didn't you say you had something tomorrow
he
night?
Board of Ed is next week.
No, we were excited about being here again.
So are we.
Unless you want to go under the assumption of 200,000.
Yeah, but look, we gave him 270 the other year, and now he came in at 190 something, so it's $70,000 more that we gave him that didn't come in. We gave it to him
right.
in the motion, that. But that it
put
actually ended up being at 190.
Yeah, right.
So.
Well, the choices are not doing the work until tomorrow night, or doing the estimate, which is a while.
You can always go on the lower side.
Well,
and
that's
then if
lower than 200.
Yeah.
That's either right. We budget with that estimate, a low estimate.
You can go lower, and if it comes, and then once we find out whatever the law is, if they get it all, if it comes in higher than what that is, we just know that we have to give it to them. But you can
right.
at least.
When are we going
to
get this legal opinion?
Well, it's not legal, but it's a matter.
You just have to read the. You just have to. Yeah.
Why don't we just do that?
I kind of.
Yeah.
I kind of think.
What is that? We went with the higher estimate. We got burned. You know.
Right.
We go with the lower estimate.
It will equate what we lost, yeah. what we were off before.
If we go with the lower estimate, we just have to cover the shortfall, right?
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
All right. Proceed.
You want to do anything more on education?
Sorry, what?
Do you want to do anything more on education or come back to it?
I think we're going to consider their budget, are we not?
Yeah, I think. I think we could.
I think the lack of people jumping in to comment on the Board of Education budget is indicative of the trepidation we bring to this process and having to deal with this budget. So I will start, and by any means, anybody can cut me off at any point in time, and I readily welcome it. I think most people are aware that I am and always have been a strong proponent of education. And that's no less true this year than it has been in prior years. The one significant change I bring to the deliberation process this year from prior years is the amount of the requested increase in the Board of Education budget. And as I look at that increase, although I understand there are requests and desires for various programs, languages, enrichment, things that children deserve and that in the ideal world we should be providing to them, I cannot help but, for myself, and I'm not speaking for the entire council, but I cannot help but conclude that a large proportion of this requested increase is attributable to personnel, to wage adjustments for classified personnel, being teachers and administrators, a very much lesser extent to the non-classified personnel, and a substantial amount of money to wage benefits. In round numbers, it appears to me that the requested increase attributable to personnel is well over $1 million. And while I understand the justification for that is it's contractual. We negotiated, we came to a contractual agreement. You guys, being us, contested it, took it to arbitration, and in case you don't remember, you lost. And an arbitrator said this was the right number, and you guys have to live with it. And I understand all of that, but the reality is we are dealing with a declining student population. Our projections show, on the numbers I've seen, a probable reduction of 54 students from this year to next year. And that does not take into account all of the students that may elect to go to either Vinyl Tech or a private prep school. So that number could be, in fact, higher than 54 students reduced from current school year to next school year. With that, I understand that we don't live in a perfect society where mathematically we can eliminate a class because 54 students are no longer in that class in the class next door. I'm not that naive. I understand that that's throughout the student body, and that it also doesn't take into account last minute registrations for kindergarten or transfers into the town because of people who move into town. So those numbers are going to be somewhat fluid, and there will be some changes, but I think the trend is quite obviously down. Confronted with that, and confronted with the fact that we have a contractual obligation to our teachers and our administrators, it seems to me that we're being told we have to fund this because the Board of Ed is committed to providing these salary increases to the current personnel population. From this side of the desk, that's not an easy sell. And the reason I find it not to be an easy sell is that although I'm sympathetic with the woman who tells me that she really wants her child to have some exposure to French in the middle school, I find myself more sympathetic to the woman that tells me she's a senior citizen and her monthly pension benefits are $1,200. In balancing those two sides of the equation, I'm afraid the scale, in my mind, tips a little more heavily in favor of that senior citizen. And while I really regret telling the parent that we cannot, or we may not have the ability to provide French in the middle school, I find that much more palatable than I would find telling that senior citizen she can't pay her taxes, or she has to choose not to feed herself to pay her taxes. With that, I come out on the side of cutting the Board of Education budget, and I'm prepared to make a motion. At least I thought I was prepared to make a motion, and now with this issue of the pass-through of state funds, I'm not really sure how it plays out. But I believe the motion that I would support, whether or not it gets a second, whether or not it carries a sufficient number of votes, I have no idea, but the motion I will make will be to reduce the increase in the Board of Education budget to $300,000 plus the special education funds from the state, estimated to be $165,000. That's my motion.
Second.
Plus the risk.
Plus the risk.
Plus the risk corridor.
I apologize. I neglected to mention, and my colleagues remind me, the funding of the risk corridor, which is an element of the town's new self-insurance medical insurance program, is approximately $314,000. That number is not in the Board of Education budget. It's on the town side of the ledger. And that will not be eliminated or reduced. That funding is available from the town side of the ledger to provide for the Board of Ed's share of funding the risk corridor, which is a key element of our employee health benefit plan.
Second.
Discussion.
Discussion.
In that motion, Joe, you mentioned the ECS money at $165,000.
Not ECS. Special ed.
Special ed.
Excess cost.
Excess cost. What happens if that number is higher? What would you suggest that? Because we don't know.
I don't know that we can make a floating reduction in the funding of the Board of Ed.
I'm not saying I guess what I'm getting at is what's...
If we got $165,000 in the first installment this year, and if Don's guess is correct that we're going to get some additional funding, but something substantially less than 165 on May 2nd, it would seem that $165,000 is a safe guesstimate, even if the state goes down to 50%. I guess the answer to your question, if the state comes back and stays at the 80% or approximately 80% figure they're using, would we be providing the Board of Ed with some additional funding? I think we would. I guess my answer to you would be, fortunately, it's not funded by way of mill rate taken out of taxpayers' pockets, but I understand that if we knew what the number was, we could further reduce the burden on the taxpayer. I don't have an answer for that. I'm just not enough of a King Solomon to be able to split that bacon.
I mean, I think I totally understand what you're saying. I think the problem with this process is there's a lot of float. There's a lot of float of student population in and out. You know, I mean, there's a lot of variables.
Well, I mean, you have retirement.
We have potentially a couple of significant
retirements. If you look historically, there's always...
Right. You know, so there's a lot of float.
Right.
You know, I mean, we could go through this process every month and there'd still be a buffer.
Joe? The risk corridor is 314?
That's my number. Okay. I think I'm close.
You're suggesting 300?
We're not cutting the risk corridor.
No.
We're not fully funding the risk corridor.
We should have emailed CCM so we could have gotten the numbers already.
65.
Or what we're getting.
I don't even know if the state got
for
the
next year.
They would give you an idea.
Okay. Oh, yeah, we can just whip right through this.
Okay. Any further discussion? Roll call? Yes.
Deputy Mayor Fawnin?
Was there further discussion?
No, I just wanted to get these three numbers. The risk corridor suggestion and the 165. Which is
I guess my question was if it's above 165.
Does it go to Anthony?
Or does it go back to general?
Yeah, because they're 100% funded now, so.
So Anthony, at some point in time, once we know those numbers, that it's a more realistic, once we get the numbers in, can we always make a motion at some point in time to give the Board of Ed more money if that excess cost grant comes in more than $165,000?
Sure. You already wanted it.
Right. Well,
Then how about on the reverse side, if it's less than $165,000?
That's what I was going to say. If you're going by the 14-15 model where you gave them 270 and you only got 190, are you saying 165 doesn't materialize?
Say it's 125.
Right. Would you rather give them the 465 increase in their budget and we keep the revenue, and if we're short, we're short?
Well, the problem with that
who takes the risk, the board or the town? That's what Will's done.
State legislature. If I'm not about to try to digest the statute sitting here, but if Sarah's interpretation is correct, we don't have any choice. We're told what to do with that money. So to answer Anthony's question, if it comes in at $200,000+, it goes to the Board of Ed.
So we're increasing their expenditure budget by $300,000. We'll give them the special ed grant checks as they come in. And we're going to pay the risk corridor of 314.
Well, I would like to not have the risk corridor as part of this motion.
It shouldn't be because it's on our side of the ledger.
Right. So the risk corridor has nothing to do with this
motion.
It's just saying that whatever we fund on the risk corridor is not part of the operating budget.
But it's an explanation.
It's an explanation for what the board is getting in funds.
Yeah. Right. So but that's not part of this motion.
So that part is clear.
Okay, so we should repeat the motion.
So it's painful.
Well, wait.
$300,000.
The 165.
Okay.
Okay.
I need a motion.
Okay.
Yeah,
it was second.
Yes, I second it.
Right, we can take a.
And I was. So what is the what's the. What happens if it's less? Then they end up getting more. And so if you're okay with
well,
that.
Well, we equate that.
Right. What do you mean? How do you equate that?
If it's under, how do we equate it? We have
right.
You say they get $100,000.
Right.
We
so that's
fine. $65,000.
Well, no, and that just means that their increase. Their increase is more than $300,000.
Right.
Ends up being more than $300,000.
That's right.
And that's basically what happens with that.
Mm-hmm. I voted.
You voted?
Yeah, I voted yes.
That's the risk.
That's
we're choosing.
What we take. Anyway.
But I'm willing to listen to the argument. You're telling us not to do it.
No, I'm just throwing it out there as to what we would do. So basically, we would do nothing. It would just go to the board, because the statute says they get all the money.
So
or we can reduce that 165.
It seems to me the trend has been such that it going to $200,000 or more, particularly knowing what we know about the state of the state economy and what's projected for next year.
Is unlikely.
It's highly unlikely.
Right.
And if anything, they may find themselves on the short end of that equation. It may be less, in which case we are going to have to fund the difference.
Right, but going forward, knowing what we do know about the state is that 165. What I'm saying is that 165 could be a high number.
It could be.
Right.
So, in effect, my motion is to cut the board's request for funding an increase of about $1.4 million to $465.
What you're saying?
No.
You're saying $300,000 and we'll give them the money to spend on top of that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, that's different than 465.
Yeah. Right.
Because that's a variable number.
Right.
Like the
2 years ago, we did it that way, Joe, where we did the number and we had to backfill it. Money came here and we were short.
Why don't we do it that way?
It's up to you.
So your motion is to increase their budget by $300,000.
That is what I said, yeah.
And then the other part of that motion is that they would get the excess cost grant up to $165,000. And if it's more than that, then we would have to make another motion once we know what that figure is.
All right, so you're amending my motion. I'll second your amendment, okay?
No, I'm just asking. That's what you stated.
I'm not sure that's what I stated.
No, that's going to be too confusing. Let's just, for your records, let's just review it. We'll withdraw your original motion?
Fine. Yeah, I'll withdraw the motion.
Okay. Withdraw
the second. I'll withdraw the second.
Okay. Now we'll start with the new motion.
Going to move to cut the Board of Education request for funding to $300,000 plus, what is the grant?
Well, I don't know, the figure you used was...
No, what is it called?
Oh, the Special Ed Excess Cost Grant.
Special Education Excess Cost Grant to the, up to a maximum of $165,000.
Second.
Right, that's your original motion.
Right.
I don't think it was.
Yeah, no, it was.
Yeah, it was close.
And then the risk corridor, you're going to do separately.
Separately.
Yes.
Yeah, that's on our side.
Yeah.
No, not right now.
Okay, no further discussion. Roll call.
Mayor Dooty?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Fawnin?
Yes.
Councilor Angeloni?
No.
Councilor Arman?
May I? Rose, what's your reservation?
I just voted no. They did a roll call vote, so I voted no.
Fair enough. Yes.
Councilor Candelara?
No.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Manna?
Yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Rose?
Yes.
So was that 7-2?
Seven.
Yeah.
Was it 300 or 465? What's it?
300
plus the special
ECS.
We That's don't have a finite number.
So just can I just ask a clarifying question? So the budget will show an additional 300,000, and then we'll get the excess costs from the town. And then, I mean, obviously, if the number's different than 165.
If it's more than 165, then once we know that number, according to what, you know, we can make a motion to give you the excess after that, once the number is definitive.
And the risk corridors on the town side.
I just want to be clear in terms of what I have to do.
Okay, move into general government services. Take whatever motions.
Mr. Mayor, I would like to make a series of motions in terms of the town budget. And I'm basing this on what I would like to eventually propose is a half-year superintendent public works. I think we've come to the point in this town where we need to help our director of public works. He's being pulled in 16,000 directions. He's unable at this point to be able to supervise. Everybody is calling upon him. He needs assistance. He needs somebody to supervise the various staffs throughout town that are out working. I will make that motion after I make some motions to where I'm looking for the money. And I'm looking for only for one half of the year, the position starting in January 2017. Okay, so my first motion then, I'm proposing to reduce line 103 overtime in the police budget
Page 57.
Page 57. Line 103 overtime.
Line 103.
Okay, I'm proposing to reduce from 223,776 to 188,000. Which gives approximately 35,000 towards this position.
So 188 even?
Yes. That's my first motion.
Second.
Discussion.
Discussion.
So is the you have to generally state
35,776.
Yeah, you state what the exact.
I'm sorry.
35,776. 35,776.
35,776.
There's been a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Yeah.
That's not, that's, I know that isn't enough to, I'm going to make another motion to make another.
Well, it has to be by each line item anyway, so it doesn't matter. So you have to go each.
You want a calculator?
42.
Yeah, I got it.
103. Tab's on this side, Anthony. 42 tab. Okay.
There we go.
Oh, thank you.
103.
It's 103.
It's 103.
All right, got 103. All right. Wait, did you repeat the numbers?
Yes. Reducing, it's 223,776 to 188,000, so it would be a cut of 35,776.
35?
Right.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. You have to help me with that number.
Okay.
Any further discussion?
I thought Anthony had something.
Roll call.
Mayor Dudi?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Conan?
Yes.
Councilor Angeloni?
Yes.
Councilor Arman?
Yes.
Councilor Candelaro?
No.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Manon?
Yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Rose?
I'm going to abstain because I'm all for cutting the budget. I just don't see adding a position. So I'm going to take the easy way out.
Okay. Well, I mean, I'm voting no. Well, we did have a hiring freeze and spur of the moment cutting public safety and not knowing what effect this is going to have on our police department concerns me. We do have the chairman here, commissioner. I don't know if he's allowed to speak, but you know, I would like to hear a little bit more of the effect this was going to have on the department.
Can we just vote?
The only thing at this point,
the vote's done.
Possibly just goes into the red on the overtime, but, you know, we're gonna have to fill the shifts no matter what.
Right.
So, but okay. We won't know that until we go ahead.
Okay.
I do have all the information that you guys have requested in every year from the last meeting.
Okay, so I would like to make a second motion. I would like to make a motion in the Public Works budget, line item 206, construction materials, to reduce that by $23,109.
And what is that material?
That material would be salt.
Reducing it by what? It's
$23,109.
Department 4305. It is 206.
Construction materials.
Second one down. Construction materials is salt. By what?
By $23,109. No, I know, but we decided to keep the number's
23,109,
does it?
23,109. Seconded?
Second.
Okay. Discussion?
Well, so Franny, what are you pre-buying this year for next year? Or, I mean, and we're taking a guess that it's going to be a mild winter again?
I mean, it's a gamble, that's for sure. I mean, if we do have money this year, fill up with all the stuff, so not much. But we do have there is some money left over in the salt account right now.
Okay.
Roll call.
What would be the proposal? I mean,
the proposal, I mean, that brings me to the proposal, my third
well,
proposal.
Well, no, I mean, so we cut the salt account and we have a hard winter next year. I mean, it's an unknown. And we cut salt out of the account now, so now we would either have to rob from someplace else in the budget or go to contingency. Correct?
Correct.
It's now less salt.
Well, last year we had a hard winter. And we had to come up with, what was the figure, do you recall? At the end of the winter, we were short by how much?
About $20,000.
Yeah, it was like $20,000.
Yeah, so there was a spending freeze and everything else to try and make up that difference. So I'm just a little
and this
hesitant.
Year, this year is a surplus of what? How much? Let me figure.
Right now, it's about, I think it's around I just ordered some salt, so it's about 700 tons right now.
Surplus wise money.
Well, it'll be in salt. Biblical times, that was
hard to put 700. 700 ton of salt.
The risk we're taking is, yes, we have a bad winter, we need more salt, we've got a problem. The flip side is, do we have adequate personnel to supervise the 17 or 18 workers we have in Public Works right now? And I'm not sure that one person can adequately do that. This is a certainty that we would have some additional supervisory personnel.
Well.
Right, but then on the other side of that also is the hiring freeze that we've had in place.
Well, it's a hiring freeze and provided without town council's approval.
I never heard of a hiring freeze.
Yeah, we talked about it. You were on sabbatical.
From the point of view of the presentations that have been made by the departments, every single one has leaned heavily on Public Works.
I totally understand that.
Right, and that's the rationale.
And we have hired people in town, you know.
But it replaced positions. It didn't add new positions.
Fran, do you want to restate your need for somebody?
So we have the ability to hire a person.
No, it's all right. I mean, we know what the rationale is, and we know what the risks are.
And there's a $60,000 surplus in salt this year. So if he buys $28,000 worth of salt, you're covered. So you'll be even. So you got that, Fran? Roll call.
Mayor Dudek?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Vaughn?
Yes.
Councilor Angeloni?
No.
Councilor Arvin?
Yes.
Councilor Candelara?
No.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Manna?
Yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Ruth?
I'm going to vote no because I'd rather fill the salt shed.
My third motion, I'd like to make a motion to add a half-year superintendent of public works. When you take into account salary, pension, medical insurance, group term life insurance, and long-term disability, it comes to a total of $58,885.
And how did you set the salary for this person?
I had assistance from the finance director and the director of public works.
So what's the salary for this new position?
It would be $58,885.
That's a half a year. What's the salary? What are we going to try and hire a guy for? And I apologize. It's the first I'm hearing of this, so yeah. You know, I just want to educate everybody, the whole town, and everything else.
But the $58,000.
So what's the salary for this new position?
70.
So we're going to go out to search for some superintendent for 70. What are the qualifications, Marie?
I certainly would leave those qualifications up to the director of public works.
I agree with that.
With your input, we met.
Okay, so you, that's what, is that the, that's about the right?
I mean, we have to come up with salary, it's a range, 70,000 is about what it is right now. That doesn't mean it's gonna be higher than that. Could be a little bit lower. There's gotta be a range, because you gotta fit it in the class.
What's your highest guy make now, other than you?
63.
Is this union or non-union?
Non-union.
It's right in the budget, Al. Cool. All the salaries are right. All the salaries are right in the budget.
63,184.
Okay.
67. I'm sorry. 67.
Okay.
Wasn't it 74,000?
Okay.
What was?
Well, that was 66,137 then there's benefits or whatever. Right. So that the person that was missing is at 66.
I did.
All set. Roll call.
Mayor Dudek?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Vaughn?
Yes.
I'm sorry, what's that?
George.
Yes.
George Taylor.
Councilor Angeloni?
I'm going to vote no, and it's not because I don't believe in the position, but given the current status in town and after hearing comments at public hearing last night, I don't think right now is the year to add positions to the budget.
Councilor Arvin?
Yes.
Councilor Candelara?
No. And I reiterate, after last night's public hearing and also the presentation that we got from our town assessor on our grand list, I don't see it getting any better next year.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Manna?
I just want to say I think it's going to improve our safety, and that's why I'm voting yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Ruth?
I'm going to say no. because I just can't get there, because, you know, if I had the votes, I would put the town hall on 4 days a week and cut everybody's pay to 4/5. So I just can't go from where I am to where you guys are. But, and I also know that Franny can get it done, because he does a great job every year. And he's still not that old. So, but I will concede that if we're going to add a position, that's a good one.
The reason I voted yes was because it's not changing the bottom line of the budget. Budget's the same, and it's going to improve service.
We just got to find the money next year too.
I know, yeah. But all votes seem to lead to public works around here.
So Anthony, the cut that was made in the police department budget, are there corresponding cuts due to Social Security, yeah, pension, and all that stuff that goes with it, yeah, which would be an additional cut?
I'll be back
there. Okay.
So clarifying, the half year would start sometime on or before or after January 1st, then, correct?
Well, if it's for a half,
yes,
year, it would have
half
to.
Half year, yeah, started January 1st.
So I'll just say that we definitely want to see the top three candidates before this council.
And you can ask the first question.
All right, I'll ask the first question.
Yep. You got any more? You're all set.
Yeah. I'm going to move to cut the uniform setup motorcycle officers allowance of $2,520 from the police budget. Is section
313. What page is that? The green book. Second.
Discussion? Discussion. Roll call.
Mayor Beattie?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor
Fawnin? Yes.
Councilor Angeloni?
Yes.
Councilor Armand?
Yes.
Councilor Candelaro?
No.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Manna?
Yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Rose?
I'm going to vote no. I love to cut stuff, but I said I was going to support that this year. So
yeah,
sticking with my word.
That was a lost battle.
Anthony,
to what?
Police
fund 20 as a result of the old tax
cut. Anthony.
Yes, sir.
On 101, 4210, 319, tuition reimbursement.
Yeah.
Is that a hard number or is that a guesstimate?
That's a contractual. That's a new contractual.
That's a number. Solid number.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you're still in police? What is?
Yeah.
Which is that account number?
That was 319. I just wanted to check it.
Right.
42,10,120.
So 42,120. What was the number?
16,296.
16,296. $16,296 is the cut. Oh. Okay. So, Marie, this goes along with your cut reducing overtime. So there would be another cut in Department 4210, which is police, 120, which would be benefits, right?
Pension, Social Security.
Pension, Social Security. For $16,296. That's the court. Do you want to make it? I don't care. I mean, but that's just corresponds to the cut that was approved. So I make a motion in account 4210,120 to cut it $16,296, which correlates to the previous cut to overtime.
Second that.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking.
Pardon me?
I'm asking you a question. I don't know.
So we went ahead and cut so much for the salt. Hmm? We went ahead and cut salt so much because you got $16,000 there on that.
And is this controversial? Can't we just vote?
I don't know. The motion was made.
No, but what she's saying is like,
let's move it into salt.
I didn't have to cut the salt as much.
So the budget ended up getting cut more than what you had anticipated. So that's a good thing.
We had to cut a little bit anyway, right?
So the motion is made and seconded.
Motion and second. Can we vote on that?
Yeah. Roll call.
Mayor Duty?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Palmer?
Yes.
Councilor Angelini?
Yes.
Councilor Arman?
Yes.
Councilor Candelara?
No.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Mena?
Yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Rose?
Yes.
Mike, can I ask a question? In the refuse budget, we're on a five-year contract, but it shows us going up, not a lot, but maybe $10,000, $15,000 from last year. What's that attributable to?
I don't know, it must have been something to the contract. I don't know if Michelle has that information or not.
Each year, when the proposal was sent in, the first and second year, I believe the dollar amount remained the same, and every year thereafter, there was an increase.
Okay. So this is the built into the contract. Yes. It was something we agreed to 5 years ago.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to make a motion in account 4401, which is community center. After the presentation that Lauren gave, and talked about the phone system at Park and Rec, I think that's an issue that needs to be resolved as soon as possible. So I would like to make a motion to cut line item 4401,319 for $2,250, and that is the NRPA conference. That's the national conference in Las Vegas that was put into the budget. And I would like to increase line item 4401,401 office equipment by $2,250. So I'm moving it from, my proposal is to move it from professional development into office equipment.
You're moving Vegas trip to more office equipment.
I am, and I did talk to Lauren in regards to this, and she feels strongly about getting the phone system corrected at the community center.
That's a good idea. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Second.
All They got brand new ones. Two brand new ones in accidents.
Which line did you cut it from?
I cut it from professional development. Which is 319. It's the $2,250, which is the NRPA conference, and that was the national conference in Las Vegas. And I moved it to line 401 office equipment.
Okay.
All these are new. They're brand new. All
right. So here we go.
Cutting one and putting that set.
Right. Right.
All
just moving
one
it
motion.
From one line to the end. And George, Councilor Miller seconded it.
Any further discussion?
When we talked about this back
at the workshop,
yeah, it was $1,500.
That was her estimate for.
And we did a little more investigating and found $2,200 is more realistic.
$5,000?
Right.
There's $3,500 in the budget already. You need another $2,000 to get to about $5,000 to make it work.
Okay, great.
So I just, yeah.
Fine.
Okay.
Roll call.
Mayor,
yes.
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 While you guys are looking, I'm gonna take a crack at it. I'm gonna go the EDC 4673. I don't know that there's a line. Where's the where's the money?
Oh, you know what? The contractual services.
Right. Okay. What's the money for the joining recs? Where's that in there? 308,
I believe that.
308. So that's just the 5,000?
Well, it's 4,800 is for recs, and then there's.
So my idea is that we, haven't done that before. And I know that the people that put it in there, are sure it's going to work. I would much rather see the Economic Development Commission go and talk to commercial real estate agents and have them come up with a price for rent or for selling and market this property. And somebody like that would have a dog in the fight. These things here, they sit there, 10 years go by, we spent $50,000. 20 years go by, we spent $100,000. And I've been here a long time. And I never see anything from it. So I'm going to make a motion to cut that. I'm just not sure. So what was that? Just the Rex one.
$4,800.
Okay.
So $4,800 is what we had budgeted.
So that's what I'm going to cut. I make the motion to cut that.
Second.
Discussion?
Discussion.
Yes. You know, that money is separate from what you're asserting, Al. I mean, the money for Rex is separate from, they're not just there to market $1,599, they're there to market, assist the town in marketing itself along with the properties that we have available, including land behind, the ice rink. That's an investment in the town. That's not really, that's an investment in our future. If we want to change the dynamic in this budget process and the dynamic in this town, you have to start marketing the town, put the town on the map. It's a very small piece, a very little bit of money to get your name out there. And as you said, you have your, the farm and different magazines around the region to get your name out there. It's the same thing for the town. And we're not on the map right now. That's why Brantford and everybody else, has people looking at their land and not us.
I respect your opinion. I just feel that we don't have I-95, I-91, Route 5, Route 1, sewers everywhere. So, I can go on. So I'm not going to agree on it,
Okay.
Making the motion to cut it.
Al,
you guys can vote however you want.
Last night I heard someone say, we need a plan. And if this is part of getting a plan, I'd like to see the investment.
Yep. I'm not gonna argue with you. I've just sat here a long time and seen money like this get thrown away.
When was the last time we appropriated funds for something like that, a program like that?
I'm glad you asked the question. There was a Yale thing with some charrettes. I rest my case.
That's a separate amount of money. As far as
anyone second my motion or not?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't want to argue with you guys. I'll call the question.
I just see it as an investment, Al.
Roll call.
Mayor Duty?
I'll pass.
Deputy Mayor Condon?
I'm going to vote no.
Councilor Angeloni?
Yes.
Councilor Armand?
No.
Councilor Candelora?
Yes.
Councilor Diamond?
No.
Councilor Manna?
No.
Councilor Miller?
No.
Councilor Rose?
Yes.
2 be continued. Al.
It'll go right there with you guys building a new high school.
Yeah.
No, Rex, keep that debt service up. You've done a good job.
Rex is good for New Haven and West Haven and the larger communities. When they started Rex five or six years ago, it won't serve the purpose that you're hoping it will serve. I know what you're trying to do, and I applaud it. I think it's great. But I don't think it's going to
But you guys are, you know, it's not much money.
Right.
Look at it in a couple of years.
Right.
See how wonderful a job they've done, and then I'll stand up here and tell you that I was wrong.
Hopefully I'll...
Just like the charrette and center plan.
Center plan doesn't cost us anything other
just
than
like center plan. Only took 8 months for you guys to see the light.
It cost me big time. So,
but anyway.
So Anthony, can you tell us where we're at?
I sure could.
I need to get business. It's not a supportable for business.
That
Rick's
coming
to him now.
I mean, desperately.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking for it now.
It's
in the back of your book. Yeah. Last page, capital.
I'm not used to looking at it.
Can we do capital tonight?
I think we're all wide open.
Can we do anything with capital tonight?
Yeah, we're doing this. We're going.
What's that?
Yeah,
no, I had something about the roof.
32.16, 1.08.
32.16.
When did we start at, Anthony? What was the proposed mill rate?
We were at 33.25.
How much money is 0.16?
It's 1.08, isn't it? 1.08.
No, 0.16. How much of them? How many thousands of dollars? Tens of thousands.
Did I miss something? Didn't say we went from 33.25 to 32.16?
Correct.
So that's a mill.
So it's an increase of 1.08.
Decrease.
Well, it's an increase over current year. That's what he gave. Okay. The 108 was a.
While he's looking, you're not going to throw this out there to you guys, and I don't have a number, but I know we have money. And I don't even know, I don't even think it, well, I guess we'd have to do it in capital. So here's my idea. We've got our $35 to $50 million new school that leaks like a sieve. Nobody's doing anything about it. So I'm willing to tackle that with your help and the building committee, and we need to address it. The problem is I haven't been in there to see what it looks like. I don't know, I know it's some of the roof, but I know from the beginning, the windows weren't put in right. And So we may have some issues there. So I know there's money there. I don't want to take you off track, Anthony, but I know there's money in that project still. Isn't there like $1.5 million left there? Come on. Well, where were we taking money from?
NBHS roof, TVES roof.
All right, so where's there's the money?
Where's this the money?
The NBHS roof?
How much do you need?
Well, over, so, what about the project at Memorial? There's going to be money left over there.
There's some excess.
All right, so here's my thing. I don't know what it's going to cost us. So I wanted to earmark that money. I want to earmark $100,000. I'm not sure whether it's going to be $25,000 or it's going to be $100,000. But if we don't earmark it, we can't fix it. And, you know, I haven't been in to see it. But when they're telling me the paint's peeling off the wall of a $35 million school, we've got a real problem. And we need to do something. So, you know, I'm saying if we earmark $100,000, we either use it or we don't out of some existing bonded project, that leftover money.
Haven't we reallocated capital dollars that were designated for a specific project to other projects during the course of the year?
Well,
what about the 120?
The bond money.
There was $60,000 that was allocated for the auditorium, which came out of general fund. What was that? Where did the $60,000?
You are correct. General fund.
Okay. So
what? I'm not investigating.
Okay. So I was on building committee when that project was at the building committee level, and I do not think that they expended any money towards that project at all, the $60,000, or if they did, it was very nominal. But I don't remember them approving any bills.
So here's the other thing, Anthony, do we have to do it in the budget process, or can we do it any time of the year?
That's what I'm saying.
I think we
do it. Oh, well, if we can do it any time of the year, then
right. We can go out and get
then
an
then we don't need that headache tonight.
And reallocate funds.
But we do need to address
you're
it
right.
As soon as we get out of budget.
You're absolutely right.
So, yeah. So there's another part of that equation that's been disregarded for many years too is the electrical in that building. When we operated it as a shelter 3 or 4 years ago, there were certain sections that were not covered by the generator properly.
Okay.
And there's been estimates back and forth. Bill's been working on it on our end, and Michelle's been involved with it. Bottom line, it's never been done. So we have a storm tomorrow. We open up the same problem that we had with Jamokes 4 years
right.
later.
So we got an issue with that school. We'll address at a future meeting.
Correct.
Okay.
The answer to your other question was 197,032.
What 0.16 is? So if we wanted to get to 32 mils, we got to come up with almost 200,000.
Yeah, that's correct.
Your game, Rose.
Okay, so
I like the cell.
So this is my proposal. On last year when we decided to go to self-insurance, we took a big gamble and we decided to fund 2/3 of it last year. There is nothing that says that we have to fund the other third this year. We can do it over a 2-year period if we want to. So instead of funding 400,000, 404, we could do it at a lesser amount.
Where are we?
Take the gamble like we did this past year and we only funded 66%. And if we went to, if we funded it at 80%, up to 80%, go from the 66 up to 80%, that would be a decrease in the funding of the risk corridor of $201,117. Part of my goal is to get a mill rate of 32 or less so that we do not have tax bills, two different tax bills, one for motor vehicle, one for real estate.
Right.
I don't think we have done enough education to the public in regards to that because it's new to us that the state just instituted this. Next year, the car tax rate cap is 29. It will be a miracle if we could get down to that level. But with the current state of our grand list and everything, I don't anticipate going to that level. But at least we would have a whole year to talk about it and to let people know why that has to be done.
So
I'm willing to take a gamble and fund the risk corridor at a lower level than up to 100%. And then the following year funded the other 20%.
I'm willing to be a gambler, but why don't we do that last?
Yeah.
If we have other cuts,
right,
maybe the number does not have to be that much, because I would be much more comfortable at 100% plus if we could get there. I don't think we can if we want to keep the mill rate at 32, which is a terrific goal, but I'd like to get as close to it as possible.
Okay.
I certainly agree with Joe on this, but I do agree, and I talked with Rose some on this. You know, I'm the biggest advocate for never taking money out of there, but we haven't funded it yet. So, and when we first started this, and when the insurance wizard was in here, he said a lot of towns take 3 years to get there. Last year, we did 2 years funding in one, and that was a smart thing to do.
Yeah.
But you know what? So now we could say, okay, this is year number two, and we're gonna be at 80% instead of 100, or maybe we can be 90%. So I'm open to wherever these other cuts are, though. So
I'd like to make a motion on page 148 under general government, public safety. For the police vehicles.
So we're in capital?
Yeah,
in
capital. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I apologize.
Okay. It's easier if you stick to the big budget book.
Which way? These guys are pulling me one way there.
That's okay.
Page 148 of the green book.
We're in the green book.
Well, I have it in the other book.
I'm used to the black book myself, so.
It's page 148 in the black book, too.
Okay.
Okay, I'm sure. I think it's a copy of the page that's in the book.
Manager proposed for two SUVs of $86,295 and bring that to $46,978 for two all-wheel drive Ford Taurus Police Interceptor all-wheel drive cars, which I have numbers that are 23, 4, 29 each.
Is that equipped? Or is that just the car? And then we have to do... So then we have to still have money in there to do
to equip them.
To equip them.
So that's not
correct.
Enough.
So that's not enough. Right?
The 23 is the base price for the car.
Right, but then...
Dave,
the equipment is another... Gary can answer that for that. But the equipment is another vendor.
I think Dave has. Mr. Palumbo, you have prices for that?
Well, I have what you guys questioned. There's a couple things here.
Is this outright purchase or lease?
Outright purchase.
State bid price.
Looking for a couple things that you guys were looking for.
Thanks.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you. And there's a couple fence posts that you guys want. They're kind of scary to look at. If you look at the, obviously we have six SUVs right now, as you can see. And if you flip to the next page, the memo from Crowley Ford is about a $2,200 difference to an SUV from a sedan. I wouldn't recommend us going back into cars when we went from cars to SUVs. We now have six SUVs. Why would we want to start purchasing cars again when, if we have six SUVs, we get two more? We've got one car out of our budget already, so if we get two, now that brings us to the eight, and as we turn these over, we'll have the equipment to move as we did with the Crown Vicks for many years. How long do we have Crown Vicks here?
I hear what your argument is, but if we cycle in two or three or four cars, then you're going to be cycling in two or three, four cars down the road. to replace those cars, you know what I mean? Like, you're gonna be cycling in new SUVs to replace the old SUVs, but you can also cycle in new cars, so, you know, and not have to buy new equipment.
What's the benefit? Yeah, what's the benefit? You're saying $2,200. What's the advantage to drive the platform?
I had it four cars, and the snow was terrible. You couldn't maneuver. You couldn't go off the Sea Hill Road. You couldn't go up Mount View Terrace. There was so much snow that would get caught under the undercarriage. For $2,200, you're going to go from a truck platform
with more storage
that can carry all sorts of equipment to a Taurus. Everybody around us, and there's a survey that we did, we're all going to the Ford Explorers.
Look at the
we're going backwards. For $2,200 per car, we're going backwards. This doesn't make any physical responsibility sense here.
Michelle, does that comport with your numbers?
Pardon me?
Michelle had the numbers from the state price for the cars.
Numbers from the
vendor itself.
Crowley Ford.
Michelle just said $23,000 a car versus $46,000 for the SUVs.
We're talking about that $23,000. It's not equipped at all. My car was $23,000. You still have to put the light bar in.
How much was your... Yeah, right. So you had a new Ford Taurus, right? You had the new one when you got hit. So how much was that?
That we bought that in 2015. It was a 2013 leftover. I think we paid around 21 or 22 for it on a state bid. But if you want to equip it, that number is not equipped.
Yeah, how much do you have to add to equip it?
Well, the difference is $2,200.
No, the equipment.
Whatever the equipment is to put in a Ford Taurus to an Explorer, the difference is $2,200.
No, because the cost that he gave for the two cars are just the base model. So then to equip the car, how much would it cost to equip, whether it's a car or
light bar, radio, flashing lights?
No. So the purchase price for us for $27,419. Totally equipped back to us is $43,404.
Okay.
It's loaded, ready to go. That's street ready.
And what about the...
it's approximately $16,000.
$16,000.
The cost to upfit the vehicle will probably not change much between the SUV and the sedan. Maybe it's $2,200 less for the purchase of the base vehicle before the equipment is installed.
Right, but the equipment is roughly $16,000, according to...
Chevy Malibu, you're going to put it into a Ford Explorer, you're going to put it into a Ford Taurus, it's all the same equipment.
There may be right. Some small, you know, differences between the cars and the SUVs, but it's not, I don't believe it's a difference.
For $2,200 to drive a Ford Explorer versus a Taurus.
Okay, well, yeah, if that's the case.
I mean, the biggest problem I see in talking to other departments is, quite frankly, the visibility is terrible in the Taurus.
Okay.
They're terrible. Look at the surveys that we did. Look at what other departments are doing. If you go down, you know, to eight towns surrounding us are getting rid of vehicles going to SUVs. The state's doing the same.
The topography of our town.
Absolutely.
Tawtucket Road.
Absolutely.
And, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know. When I checked with our vendor, because I knew this was going to be coming up, for every 20 Ford Explorers he sells, for every 20, he sells one Taurus.
Okay. I mean, again, I made the motion with the understanding that there was a much bigger price difference than...
You were given the wrong information.
Yeah, the equipment's the equipment.
It's funny.
And I think you're going to get a better bang for the buck for the SUV. Sensibly, we already got six. Just like the Crown Vic. We carried those for years and moved equipment from one to another to another. You would do the same with the Explorer. Why would we want to have a mixed fleet? I run 100 pieces of equipment, I run them all the same. Interchangeable, much easier to interchange everything. So.
Thank you.
And you got defense corps. They're staggering numbers. Staggering numbers.
So Dave.
I apologize we didn't have the third one, we didn't get it.
According to this, you're telling us the overall trend around the shoreline is everybody's going to the Explorer.
Where's the trend?
What the trend?
Yeah. Oh, that? That's a trend?
And if you look at Brown's last paragraph, what they mentioned.
Have you talked to any of these towns?
Yes.
I had my sergeant call the towns and do a survey.
So where it says East Haven, half of four Explorers, are you telling me that within the next couple of years, the full fleet will be four Explorers? Is that the trend?
They're phasing out the vehicles that they have.
So North Haven too, half the fleet is four Explorers. You're telling me within the next couple of years, the full fleet will be four Explorers. That is the trend.
That's what the information they're giving us. They find more successful vehicles.
I could understand the consistency of cars rather than a little this, a little that.
So you can't compare.
The savings is only $4,000.
Right.
I think when you purchase them, you're going to see.
I live up to the hills.
I don't want to buy inferior equipment for $84,000. If it's $20,000 savings, then I'm on board.
Yeah. I've had a problem for decades.
So you thought all right. The gap would be more. Their side.
I'll withdraw my motion.
Just so I'm clear, Michelle, you have the state prices. You gave me $23,000 for the Ford Taurus.
That's the base price, correct?
That's the base price, no equipment.
Correct.
And I'm assuming the equipment that's needed is virtually the same thing for the sedan versus the Explorer.
Correct.
You need a light bar, you need a cage.
The light bar on an SUV may be a little bit longer, and maybe a 48-inch light bar on an SUV versus a 36.
We're talking they're comparable prices.
Comparable prices.
And what is the state price for the Ford Explorer?
What's that?
27.4? Unequipped?
I got
27.4 unequipped.
When I looked at the state bids, the engine that's in the basic Ford Taurus, it could be different from what you would put into a police interceptor. So you're adding, could be possibly the
so it'll be higher.
$1,000. For a police interceptor vehicle versus the base, Taurus base.
And that's the only price you got was the Ford Taurus. You didn't inquire
that's
about
that. That's all that's on state contract for.
Okay.
Substantial difference between a police interceptor versus a Ford Taurus that you and I can buy off the lot.
Okay.
Well, those prices were Ford police sedans for 23. Ford police sedans, not interceptors. They're Ford police sedans, they're the same thing as an interceptor. It was 20, all-wheel drive was, I believe, 23, or in
23.
Front-wheel drive was 22.
Right. So how bad is it if we go to just buying one car this year?
Buy one SUV?
Yeah.
I guess
I'm
so.
Asking.
Well, look.
I'm asking you guys. So
look at the mileage there, and if you look at the mileage right now, this was February, and you're averaging 3,000 miles a month. In 3 months, you got 90,000 more miles, and so on. In 6 months, you got 18,000 miles. You look at the 2011s. You got again 90,000 on car two. You got car. Four, you got 90 on it. These were back in February. You got car. Six.
Yeah, but they'd easily go 200,000 where they're running all the time.
Okay.
How
many? Well, again, you know that these are only on the odometer, not
the engine.
Dave, my math is a little bit off from yours. These are 5 years old. With 90,000 miles on them.
You're looking at the 11s. You got
the three of them with 90,000 miles on them.
Yeah, you got 90.
I got like 1,800 miles a month.
What's that?
I got like 1,800 miles a month.
2,500 miles a month? You guys do 3,000?
No, let's not stretch it too much.
What's that? Right. But you're averaging
I haven't seen one with 3,000 miles a month yet. The three I added up.
Average, like,
These are five. These are all 5 years.
Okay, so.
Five.
Well, depending on what
I guess our options. How many are missing the floorboard?
How many floor?
With a catalytic converter. Just wondering.
How many are missing floorboards? How many have we fixed? How many are missing? Well, we just did the inspection over here with you guys last month. What are we at?
So we guess we're going to one SUV.
One car in dire need and another two or three that are in need of repair.
And we have our police dog in one of them?
The police dogs are one that we just found on the inspection when Lieutenant and I were there last month that before we brought it and just about touching the floor matting was touching the exhaust just about.
Okay.
Anybody make a motion?
We don't have a motion.
I withdrew it.
Al, did you make a motion?
No, I wasn't. I was asking the question. Okay. Now, when I looked at the repairs, and I know so they go everywhere. Do they go to Franny and they go to the other garages? Because it didn't look like we spent an awful lot this year. And I do, you know, I've been here a long time, so I understand the two cars, three cars. Sometimes we've gone to one car. Sometimes we did no cars. So my question is this a year we could survive with one car? Just like cutting the risk corridor for something, you know? So it is a gamble.
It is, could anything happen? You know, Sal, you've got to work from like I do. Every time I think I'm going to get rid of something or I'm going to buy something, you know, a motor goes, I just put a motor in a truck, it's 30 grand. Now I'm stuck sitting on this truck. You know, could a motor go, could a rear end go? Yeah, will we fix it? Absolutely. It's entirely up to you guys. I'm only giving you the information that you asked for at hand. I don't want to see, because several years ago when I got in, I voted zero budget, no car, nothing. And it did it bite us in the rear end? It did. So
how many did we get? How many did we get last year, Neil?
Three.
We got three.
We got three last year. How about the year before?
I don't know.
We had a year of four.
That was the least. Right.
Yeah, well, we're paying that last year on the lease.
Right, so we've been getting, but we've been getting cars every year because there were years when we didn't get cars. That's how we got into that trouble.
Right,
because of year zero.
We haven't got.
I was going to go with one.
There were years that we didn't get any cars because they were on the 3-2 schedule, 3-2, but there was a year when we didn't get
cars. It's entirely up to you guys.
If and we then, gave one, I mean, and there's a worst-case scenario, can they come back to us?
We're over $18,000 in repairs under the current fleet.
Okay.
And if you only replace one,
it's coming out of state aid. It's not an effect on the
Is that what you have for bills, Anthony, $18,000?
It's coming out of state aid money. So
is that what you have for bills, $18,000?
There's no effect on the mill rate.
What do you want? One
or two. For two, you're saying, for anything.
What doesn't affect
the mill
rate? This capital expense. This because it's all coming out of the state grant. So if we don't spend it on this, it'll just sit there, or we can spend it on something else. So that's what it comes down to.
Right.
Because it's not affecting the mill rate. It's not coming out of general fund money. It's not coming out of tax dollars.
Thank you for clarification.
So
that's important.
Yeah, if you do one this year or you do two, none of us can sit here and have a crystal ball to say what we're going to kind of shape we're going to be next year. I made that mistake the first year in, and I said it was a costly one with repairs, and it happened to go to four cars, to three cars, to try to get on, even if it's a 1-2, you're better off doing something than not doing anything, because, and I don't remember what department it was, did the same thing.
Well, it was again, I apologize, because I was under the impression there was a much bigger price disparity.
No need to apologize.
So then my goal is just for the same amount of money, let's say we can get one more car on the road, you know, but it,
yeah.
I understand what you're saying.
I mean, you know, just by mental madness of only 100 pieces of equipment, I try to keep all my fleet the same.
That makes sense, you know, which I wasn't aware of.
We did it with Crown Vicks for many, many years. Now the Crown Vic, if the Crown Vic was still in existence, maybe we would still have that. I don't know. It's not And that's kind of why we did a survey of 8 towns around us.
Michelle, how did we get from 24,000 to 33,000 that we approved for a replacement car? Yeah, current one. Didn't we do a transfer of 16,000 for a $33,000 car?
Those are insurance monies.
I believe that was replaced in that car that was totaled.
Yeah.
What was the cost on that car?
Were you saying it was a 14 or something like that?
No. My car is, I bought that in 2015. That was left on 2013.
Oh, 13.
Now I have an SUV that's just a normal family SUV.
Right.
Now, police package. It's not meant to be a police package. There's the undercarriage, which is a normal undercarriage. There's no heavy duty suspension, alternator, or whatever.
So we don't know what that costs.
Next.
Could I make a suggestion that if you're looking back to the number of 32 mills and looking for 197, that I'd suggest we take a look at a couple of items, contingency that you might want to look at.
I got one other item.
Ambulance fund, then the fund balance, and then last risk corridor. I think if you're looking for big numbers.
I got one. 101, 42, 20, 320, other contractual. CMET Anthony is 26,241, but I believe Metcom is what, 10,000?
What are we under?
101, 4220 communications, 320, other contractual. What is that?
40.
320, other contractual.
Right, 4240 department.
Yeah, CMET. That should be reduced as we're no longer in CMET.
I think we're in a situation currently with Metcom. I'm not sure if that's where we're going to be our permanent home. Well, okay. Fire chief has advised we can keep it around 12.
So that's a $14,241 cut.
Where are you?
320. 101, 4240.
4220?
No. 4240.
Oh, okay. All right, I was just in the wrong. Okay. 4240. Okay.
65. Reducing that to 12,000? Is that what the?
Reducing that to 12,000.
12,000? No, I'm sorry.
But I thought we were going to be in this just until June, and then we could, because it was a 1-year contract with CMET, correct? And then we have to figure out what we're going to do, whether we stay in CMET or go someplace else.
Yeah.
Between now and June.
If you looked at an option road, yep, that 12,000 would be okay for that other option.
And it would it be okay if we stayed in CMET?
CMET's no longer.
Or Medcom, whatever we're in now.
To my knowledge, there's no talk of an increase.
So the 12,000 would be okay for next year for Medcom or another option? Right.
It's like $14,000.
$14,241.
All right, before we make that motion, can I just clarify on the police cars? We're taking no action, which in effect means the capital outlay for two SUVs stays in the budget. Is that correct?
Yes.
I believe
they said it's a grant, right?
Correct. It's state aid, yes. Money, so.
But I just want to be clear, and I want the chief and Dave to know that,
right,
that we're not doing anything. They're, yep, you're getting two SUVs.
Two SUVs stay in the budget.
All right.
You have another
Let's
question?
Let's go on to this one.
No, I'm good, thank you. Do you guys need any other information?
No, you beat us up enough.
I do want the fence. I just got to find the money.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks for painting the door. So it's good.
I made that motion.
I move to reduce, what section is this?
4240.
4240.
320.
320, allocation for CMed at 26241 to $12,000.
Discussion, roll call.
Oh, second.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
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 Nobody has anything else, we can go back to Rose's motion.
Well, Mike had suggested.
Yeah, what was your suggestion again, Mike?
I think we should take, we bumped contingency, I think there's some wiggle room there, you might want to take a look at that. I think there's some, I think we should take a look at maybe ambulance fund as well. And then, you know, there's always, as we discussed earlier on, the whole issue of fund balance, if you want to allocate more or not. And then lastly, risk corridor.
So, what's the first one? What was the first one that you, oh.
Contingency.
Contingent, how much is in contingent, how much is allocated for contingency now?
125.
Which is up from what we normally?
Yeah.
Yeah, we historically have done 75, and then we've gotten very close the last couple of years. We went to 150 initially, and then as we tried to whittle down the budget, we're down to 125.
Yeah.
We've also talked, we've made a cut to salt, we've also talked of possibly a primary in August. Advised by the registrars, at least it might be, not be a contingency appropriation as well.
Was that like $5,000?
No, 10-ish.
10?
It, well, it would be five to one, five if there's a Democrat, but if we have two, it'd be five for the Republican, five for the Democrat.
Okay.
We won't know that until July, but it's not in the registrar's budget. It typically gets cut according to contingency.
Okay.
Worst case scenario, $5,000.
So you said we've come close to the 75, we've been running close to the 75?
This year, obviously, with the winter being good, we were good. But the last couple of years, you recall the spending freeze, and we set the contingency down, everything else. And we made it pretty clear, we're going to try to give ourselves a little buffer to, you know, 150, we thought. But then, again, if we try to get down to the numbers, makes sense, we said, okay, we'll take 25 off just for the heck of it.
So we could take another 25 and give you an increase of 25 to 100?
Yeah, I guess so.
Or gambling.
Well, it's a gamble, I mean, the dice are out tonight, holy cow. We're betting the house tonight, holy, we're betting lotto or something, I don't know.
60.
Well, would you prefer that we take increase, take out of the general fund and increase the 350, or decrease contingency?
I'd like to leave the general fund alone.
I know.
Yeah, I'd go back to 100, you want to go back to 100, contingency, you know, whack 25 there.
Anthony, if we're, since we're on this subject of trying to hit 32 mils, if we're over 32 mils.
Yes.
You have to send extra bills out?
No. No, what happens is, there's two mil rates. So your motor vehicle bills will be at 32 mils for the state cap. And if you look on the front page of the budget, the way it's spelled out on here is that the 3325, where we started tonight, would be for your personal property and real estate. So you'd get a car tax bill at a 32 mil rate.
Right, so my question is there a cost to us to create?
Our vendors assured us they can accommodate both mil rates. It's the state law, they have to accommodate. So would it be confusion? Potentially. Is it impossible? Certainly not. Is it doable? It's within our possibility to do it, sure. I think Rose's point is more of an education piece, where if people see different mil rates, is that going to cause more confusion than anything else? Logistically, we can do it.
Okay.
So what was your motion on the?
So I would like to make a motion to cut contingency by $25,000.
Second. Discussion. Roll call.
Mayor Dooty?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Fawnin?
Yes.
Councilor Angeloni?
Yes.
Councilor Arvin?
Yes.
Councilor Candelara?
Yes.
Counselor Bennett?
Yes.
Counselor Manna?
Yes.
Counselor Miller?
Yes.
Counselor Rose?
Yes. So now we need to know what we need.
Did Mike have a third one other than the general fund? What?
Ambulance fund?
Is that extra?
Well, we subsidize it, it's just whether, you know, you wanna try to make, again, roll the dice and try to make it up next year.
Right, they're already in the red.
They're already in the red.
So, do we want them to be less in the red? Or do we wanna try to get closer to zero, or it'll just take us longer? At some point in time, we have to get to zero.
How do we get them out of the red?
Give them more money.
No.
Hey, Al, it's an act of Congress, right? I mean, it's gonna be about the payer rate, that's not Medicare, right?
How do we get paid?
Well, that's...
It's not a question of getting paid, it's getting paid the right amount.
The right rate, getting the right...
Yeah.
Wow.
So what are we, so Anthony, we have what, a hundred and...
75.
75 in ambulance, which would make us in the red how much compared to what we are? Because we're already in, we're still in the red. We're just trying to reduce that.
Well, who do we owe the money to?
The fund balance, in that fund.
Oh, okay.
The fire commission had asked for $200,000, but it resulted in a negative fund balance of about 30. We reduced it already to 175, which will result in a negative fund balance of about 53. For this year, if you go back a couple, we were 76 in the hole last year. We're estimated to be about 64 in the hole at the end of this year. So 53 is an improvement. It gets us, you know, there's a path. That's not the immediate path, but I think the, as Andrew mentioned, that if there's a game plan in place and there's some desire to get the fund back to whole, whether it's this year or next year, it really is, you know, a moot point. But if you go, went down, let's say to 150, just for the sake of argument.
I would rather not fund the risk corridor and try and get this back up there. But
I don't want to dig this hole any deeper.
Yeah.
Going in the right direction, I don't want to go backwards.
That brings you to about 79 in the hole, that fund. And the auditors recognize it's a fund with a negative fund balance, and they question it. And in the past, we've been able to say that there's a path, you know, we're getting there. It's not an immediate fix. I mean, there's not an onslaught of money to bring it back to zero, and the council's working on it over time. I think if we went to that number, it actually brings us backwards a little bit. We're beginning this year around 64 in the hole.
So is it that we don't get paid for the rides, or we don't get paid enough?
We don't get paid the proper people.
You don't get paid the full amount that you're allowed to charge.
Okay.
It's a set rate by the federal government for Medicaid and Medicare transports.
Because that's the bulk of your transports are Medicare and Medicaid, so that's...
The mix.
Yeah, that's a smaller percentage.
Just as an example of it, the state says we can charge $682 per ride. That's our billable rate to the private payers. To Medicare, we charge $390. To Medicaid, we charge $196. So the lion's share, as the chief had mentioned earlier, one of the analysis that our payer mix is heavily to the Medicare A older population. So while the percentage of collection is good, it's of a much lower number.
Okay.
Same with the Medicaid, the percentage is decent to collect, but it's a very much lower number. Versus the people that are paying prior pay that would try to pay the full amount, it's a very low percentage. So the mix is against us, basically. And as the chief had mentioned, also that's typical in any, you know, billing type emergency ambulance situation where it's not a money maker.
Is that money alone?
Yeah.
So what do we need now? Does Anthony, first of all, do you guys all agree we'd like to get to 32?
We should leave that alone.
Yeah.
Are you okay with funding the risk corridor at a lower amount?
How much lower, though, are we talking about?
Well, that's what he's saying right now.
We're going to go up from last year. So.
We're going to fund some of it, but it's just going to be at a lesser amount.
Less than the goal of 100.
Right.
Like I said, I'm okay with not funding it, just never taking it out of the bank.
For $160,000, you need.
Okay, so we could fund it, if we funded it at 83% and from 80, that would be a decrease of $170,949.
How'd you get that so quickly?
Yeah, how did you know that?
Because I already calculated it, because this is an area that I was looking at to try and save the taxpayers' money, because this is a direct impact on the mill rate. And so I worked my numbers.
Okay, so your motion is?
How much, what's the split? You've taken a half and half, or whatever the proration amount is?
The 76.24, the, what you handed us. Do I need to break, do we need to break it down between?
Yeah,
stand by, let me figure out.
Well,
yeah,
stand by. We haven't bothered Bob Hall.
That's okay, he'll feel bad about it.
Maybe we can give him some money.
Do we have any say?
When
you want to go to Department 4734.
4734.
Benefits.
Is
that our side or?
That's our side, yeah.
Benefits. 4734,
yeah.
Benefits.
Item 721 on the top there, the third item down.
Yep.
You want to reduce that by 41028.
41028?
Correct.
Okay, I make a motion to decrease line item 4734.721 by 41,028.
Is that intentionally, Anthony? There's two lines, 721, health insurance.
Yeah, there's a sub-function that you don't see there.
Okay. I'll second the motion.
Discussion? Roll call.
Mayor Dooty?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Fonin?
Yes.
Councilor Angeloni?
Yes.
Councilor Armand?
Yes.
Councilor Candelora?
Yes.
Councilor Diamond?
Yes.
Councilor Manon?
Yes.
Councilor Miller?
Yes.
Councilor Rhodes?
Yes.
And then the second cut would be in Department 4900. Operating transfers out. There's no sub-function there. You just cut the Board of Ed risk corridor by 129,921.
All right, I'd make a motion on item line item 4900, transfer to Board of Ed risk corridor. I make a motion to cut it $129,921.
Second.
Was that 129?
$129,921.
Somebody second it? There was a second. Dan, second it. Discussion? Yes.
Deputy Mayor Honan?
Yes.
Counselor Angeloni?
Yes.
Counselor Arden?
Yes.
Counselor Sidora?
Yes.
Counselor Bennett?
Yes.
Counselor Manna?
Yes.
Counselor Miller?
Yes.
Counselor Rose?
Yes.
Nothing.
We got one question for Anthony. 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 101, 42, 40, 120.
So what is that number, Anthony?
It's up to $90,000. That's a big jump, $31,000 jump.
Where are you, Michael, sir?
42, 40, 120. Pension and Social Security. Why such a big jump? Is that a hard number?
42.
Or a guesstimate?
You have two relatively new employees there who were not on pension previously. They're after 1 year, so they're back on pension. That's why the 120 is a big jump. And you also have some police officers in there, and their pension is on there as well.
So you're happy with that number?
Yes.
Okay.
Right now, you're at 31.98.
How much more, Anthony?
Franny can get some more salt.
Yeah, buy a couple more trucks.
Yeah, there's a little salt shaker.
So if I did the calculation correctly, compared to what the article in the paper said, that it was a 7.4% increase in taxes, at this mill rate, it looks like it's a 2.89% increase.
I think one of the most important slides last night that the manager put up that everybody kind of glossed over was the actual dollar impact. I think Councilor Poynton was going towards it.
Right.
We see the 7.9% increase in the mill rate, we all get, you know, googly-eyed about it. But if you look at the slide that Mike had, when your assessment went down,
right,
the net impact was $200 per resident. It wasn't really catastrophic. It was like, and it was 2% of change. It was some, you know, reasonable number. I think people got that, lost that in the translation.
Well, I don't know where the 7.4 came from, because at the new, when you gave us the corrected sheet with the 2.17% or 2.17 mil increase,
right,
that equated to like a 6.96% increase.
You're correct.
Which actually went, so it went up from where it was before, but yet not, it's still lower than 7.4. So I don't know.
That was this newspaper, wasn't it?
Yeah. No, I know. So I don't know how they calculated it or if someone gave them that number, but that was incorrect. So that's, a lot of people got upset about that and were upset because of the huge increase, but.
You're just demonstrating why Donald Trump really is right. It's a mad media.
The mad media.
The media is out to get us.
Thanks, Dory. This is John. You have that one. No, I already got one.
You wrote. All right.
Yeah, we covered. We covered capital. We covered debt service. So we don't need tomorrow night's meeting, right?
Unless you have more cuts or increases. We shouldn't need any more, right?
No.
Well, he needs.
If we're satisfied.
Yeah, but we've got to, I mean, actually vote to finalize, and then there's a question we've got to do as well.
Does that have to be done before the April 19th meeting? Because Lisa,
we could do it on the 19th.
In order for the referendum, the budget referendum, which is in May, when do we have to have everything adopted and approved? You know, 2 weeks before, so we could.
Three.
So at the April 19th town council meeting, we could finalize everything, make the question and everything. Okay. So we don't need another meeting before then.
Sorry.
Is what it comes down to.
Do we need a vote on a hard number tonight or not?
I guess, Anthony, you want time to go through and we'll finalize everything on the 19th?
Until next meeting.
Yeah.
So a motion to adjourn tonight?
Right.
So move to adjourn.
Second.
Yes.
Mayor, yes.
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 Miller.
Yes.
Councilor Rose.